Hello, I'm Dr. Aizaz from medicovisual.com, and in today's visual lecture, we will talk about the development of adrenal glands or suprarenal glands. These glands are sitting on the top of the kidney, so they are also called suprarenal glands. Now, the suprarenal glands or adrenal glands, they actually consist of two different types of structures. The superficial structure is basically the cortex, adrenal cortex, and the deeper one is the adrenal medulla. Now, these cortex and medulla, it appears as if they are two totally different organs. They have totally different functions and they have totally different origin. Of course, the cortex, it is further subdivided into three layers that we will not discuss right now. And medulla is a single type of layer, but both of these, cortex and medulla, they are totally different types of structures. Of course, they are part of the single organ, but it looks like that they are totally different types of organs, but actually they are not. It is just for the concept. And by the way, the outer cortex, it is mesodermal in origin, and the inner medulla, it is ectodermal, basically neuroectodermal in origin. Actually, they are derived from the neural crest cells. So now let's talk about the development of adrenal gland. Now here is the transverse section of the embryo, and here you can see that this is the urogenital ridge. This is, by the way, neural tube. So here is the urogenital ridge, and here is the this structure is the GI tube, a cross section or transverse section of GI tube. And GI tube is connected to posterior body wall by the structure called dorsal mesentery, or simply mesentery, because ventral mesentery, it is mostly destroyed. So what remains is the dorsal mesentery, which is called mesentery of GI tube. Now, between the mesentery and the urogenital ridge, somewhat here, between the mesentery and urogenital ridge, here this part of celomic epithelium, it will proliferate to form the adrenal cortex. So, adrenal cortex will form somewhat here. And of course, the neural crest cells, they will aggregate and they will go inside this to form the medulla. Just simple as that. I think it's very easy to teach the development of adrenal gland. So, basically, in simple terms here, let's talk about that this adrenal gland, it develops between the mesentery and the urogenital ridge. Now, we will take just a small part of it. We will assume that we are taking a section, a very small part of it. Let's suppose something like that. Let me explain it to you. So, if we are taking a section, something like that, I hope you can understand. And then we will see what is going inside it. So here is the small section, and here again the GI tube, and here is the mesentery. Here there will be the urogenital ridge, which I haven't shown, and somewhat here the gland will form. And by the way, this is just the right side. I have removed the left side to keep our focus aligned here. Now, from this celomic epithelium, this is the celomic epithelium, which is basically the somatopleuric mesoderm, intra-embryonic somatopleuric mesoderm. I hope you know these things from the previous lectures, so I will not go into details. If you don't understand, please watch the basic embryology lectures on our YouTube channel. So the celomic epithelium, here the cells will proliferate from this celomic epithelium to form an aggregate somewhat here. Let me show you the animation. So here you can see that cells from the celomic epithelium, they proliferated and then they moved from here somewhat posteriorly or dorsally to form an aggregate of cells. And this aggregate is basically the fetal cortex. It is called fetal adrenal cortex. Why it is called fetal adrenal cortex? Because it is quite active during the fetal life, but as the baby is born and as it starts to grow, most of it is, almost all of it is degenerated. And then there is another layer, another part of this cortex that remains, and that is the adult cortex. So this is the first generation, or you can say first wave of proliferation, proliferated cells that came from the celomic epithelium. Similar to this first wave, another wave will arise to form yet another cortex, yet another layer of cortex that will form the definite cortex or adult cortex. This is the primordial cortex or fetal cortex. Another wave will form the adult adrenal cortex, similar to previously discussed. So here we have the adult cortex. Now that was about the development of cortex. Now let's talk about the development of the medulla. Now if you focus here, this is the neural tube, and we have discussed in the topic of neurulation that as the neural tube forms, the neural crest cells also developed. So let me briefly tell you here, just review that this is the ectoderm. So here was the ectoderm. So this ectoderm, basically it invaginated, it worked somewhat here, it invaginated to form the neural tube, somewhat like this. It invaginated to form the neural tube. Now some of the cells here at its edges or crest, they went sideways to form these cluster of cells called neural crest cells. Now basically the neural crest cells, they are like the representatives or ambassador of central nervous system to different parts of the body. As you know, in the diplomacy, for example, if we talk about USA sends its ambassador to different countries, to India, to South Korea, Japan, and different countries. So similar to that, this CNS, the neural tube, which will form the CNS, this neural tube, it will send its representatives to different parts of the body, and these representatives, they are going to form some very important structures in our body. So here, if we talk about, they are going to form the adrenal medulla, and along with that, they are going to form some ganglias, the aggregates of nerves in different parts of the body. Now today, our focus of discussion is not the ganglias. We will discuss that in the topic of nervous system when we will talk about development of nervous system. But basically, they are the aggregates of nerve fibers, and they are also derived mainly from the neural crest cells. So here they will form the dorsal root ganglia. And then they will send they will proliferate, and they will send some neural crest cells somewhat here to form another ganglia. And this is, by the way, sympathetic ganglia. And then from here, another proliferation of fibers, neural crest cells, they will go near the developing suprarenal or adrenal gland to form the adrenal medulla, an aggregate which is actually the primordium of adrenal medulla. Right now it is not medulla. Medulla by definition is inside, it is deeply seated in the adrenal gland, but here it is right now outside, but later it will go inside, and it is basically the primordium of medulla of adrenal gland. And by the way, why it is derived from something that represents the nervous system? Because, and specifically from the sympathetic ganglia, because the sympathetic neurons, they release a chemical called norepinephrine, and to some extent epinephrine, which is involved in fight and flight response. Without going into details of nervous system physiology, just briefly, I will tell you that this epinephrine and norepinephrine, they are most important chemicals of the fight and flight response. Now, they are released from the norepinephrine, basically. It is mainly released from the nerve endings of the sympathetic ganglia, sympathetic nerve endings, basically. Not just ganglia, mainly the sympathetic nerve endings. They are going to release norepinephrine mainly and little to no epinephrine. But opposite to that, a similar structured compound, which has quite similar functions, but of course there is some differences as well. We will not go into that. That's a whole lot of a different topic. But the other substance that is similar to norepinephrine, but not exactly alike, that is epinephrine. And epinephrine is mainly secreted by adrenal medulla. So that is why the adrenal medulla is involved in the fight and flight response at adrenal cortex. It is going to release a totally different types of hormones. That is why I said that it looks like that there are two different organs aggregated together. So that is the one reason I said that. Now here is this adrenal primordium of adrenal medulla. I'm gonna make it more simplified, and we will watch the animation and we will see how it goes inside. And that's all about the development of adrenal gland. Now here is the primordium of adrenal medulla, and what it will do is that it will try to go inside this, and here its shape will change something like this, and ultimately what will happen that here these edges will meet together, these edges will meet together, and of course these edges, they will also meet together, the fetal cortex. And ultimately what will happen that this adrenal medulla's primordium, it is now happily inside the adrenal gland. So let's watch it. So here we can see that it is now inside that gland. Now here, as we have discussed already, that the fetal cortex, it will mostly degenerate. But why there is such a huge fetal cortex at first place? The reason is that it is going to release an important chemical. It is called DHEA, dihydroepiandrosterone. Dihydroepiandrosterone. So this DHEA, it will be picked up by placenta. So we have placenta. So it will be picked up by placenta, and this placenta, it will convert this DHEA into estrogen and progesterone as well. So it is basically the precursor of estrogen. In most of the textbooks, they write estrogen, but I don't know why they just ignore the progesterone, because it is also the precursor of progesterone. If you go into the books of biochemistry and other literature, you will come to realize that it is also the precursor of progesterone. But I don't know why the textbooks of embryology, they just tend to ignore the progesterone altogether. Even though it is a very important hormone of the pregnancy, and without it, the pregnancy cannot sustain. It might lead to miscarriage if there is critically low level of progesterone. So because so much of these hormones are being synthesized by the placenta, so placenta needs this raw material in a bulk quantity, and this raw material is being synthesized by fetal cortex. Of course, after the birth, we do not need such a huge amount of DHEA. Of course, we need it, but not in that much amount. So most of it will degenerate and only the adult cortex will remain. So that was the answer to that question. So as I have told you, that the adult cortex will remain like this, and the rim of this cortex, it will condense to form a capsule. And here you can see it will condense to form a capsule, and this cortex will then be further subdivided into three layers. This third layer, let me tell you first the names of these layers. So if you want to remember the names of these layers, you can remember it from GFR, glomerular filtration rate. Of course, it has nothing to do with GFR, but it is just a phrase to make you remember. So here G stand from glomerula, zona glomerula. And then F stands for zona fasciculata. This is the zona glomerula. This is the zona fasciculata. And then this is the last one is the zona reticulata. Now this zona reticulata, it develops after the birth, again, just by proliferation of this adult cortex. Another layer, a small layer is formed after the birth. This is the zona reticulata. Zona glomerulosa, it will be forming the aldosterone. And from this term glomerulosa, you can remember that it has something to do with the urinary system. So aldosterone is the hormone that acts on the kidney, and I will not explain what it does because we will then go into altogether a different path of renal physiology. Of course, I will explain renal physiology. I will teach renal physiology to you one day, but not today. This is not the time to talk about renal physiology. Let's come back to embryology. Then there is the zona fasciculata, which is going to form the glucocorticoids. And then finally, zona reticulata, which is going to form DHEA and some sex hormones. I think sex is a private business. It's a private thing. So sex hormones are being released from these much deeper layers. So the watery stuff is outside. Then there is the glucocorticoids. Again, I'm not going into details of its functions. And finally, the sex hormones, they are going to be released from the zona reticulata. The adrenal gland is initially the oval-shaped gland, and here you can see the kidneys are there. Now kidneys, they initially developed in the pelvic region, but they ascend upward, and as they ascend upward, they also rotate 90 degree, and their hilum, they come to lie medially. So as the kidneys ascend, glands, they also degenerate to a greater extent. They become smaller, and the kidney, the top of kidney, the upper pole of kidney, it is sort of pushed into the lower part of this, and the shape of gland, adrenal gland, is slightly changed. Here you can see. So here you can see the shape has changed, and here the lower part, the lower side, it has become more of a concave shape like this. So now the adrenal gland, these are basically the just like the caps of the kidney. They are sitting on the top of kidney, and that is why they are called suprarenal gland. Thank you so much for watching this video.